Hi friends, myself Dr. Mahesh Lohit KS, Associate Professor and Head, Department of Physics, ATME College of Engineering, Mysuru, welcome you for this lecture 3 on module 3 of Engineering Physics 18PHY 12/22. In continuation of previous discussions, today in this session, we shall have a discussion on the fundamentals of vector calculus. So, the topics of today's discussion are scalar field, vector field, the differential operator del or nabla, the gradient of a scalar function, divergence of a vector function, and finally, the curl of a vector function. These are the topics. First of all, let us understand what is a scalar field. Scalar field is a region of space in which each and every point is associated with a scalar quantity. For example, let us consider a charge. Let us say we have a charge here, let us say it is a positive charge, and around this charge there is a space, there is a region, and in this region we can associate each and every point with a scalar quantity called electrostatic potential. So, the region surrounding this charge is a scalar field of electrostatic potential. Similarly, let us consider this room. There is a region of space in this room. Each and every point in this region of space is associated with temperature, and hence it is a scalar field of temperature. For the sake of visualization, there is an image here. This is a thermal image of a hand of a person. Here, the different shades represent different temperatures. For example, here a particular point here, there is a particular shade and it represents a particular temperature. Like this, each and every point in this hand is represented by a shade, which in turn represents a particular temperature. So, this is how we can visualize a scalar field. Having understood what is a scalar field, let us now understand what is a vector field. A vector field is a region of space in which each and every point is associated with a vector quantity. For example, consider a charge in space. Let us say we have a positive charge here, and there is a region surrounding this charge. So, each and every point in this region is associated with electric field strength or electric field. So, each and every point in this region is associated with a vector quantity. So, this region is called electric field. Similarly, let us say there is a surface, and water is flowing on this surface, water is flowing. Now, you can consider region on this, region in this water. Each and every point is associated with the velocity of a particle. The particles, they pass through that point during their motion. Therefore, each and every point in this region is associated with a vector quantity, that is velocity. So, this is a field of velocity. So, it is a velocity field. Similarly, the field set up by a magnet in the region surrounding is called as the magnetic field. You can see the magnetic field lines here. Okay. So, there is a continuous path for this, This is about the vector field. Both the vector fields and scalar fields are functions. So, we call them as a scalar function and vector functions. In vector calculus, we often refer to an operator called del operator. It is also known as a vector differential operator, and it is denoted by a symbol nabla. This del operator operates on a function and it instructs to differentiate that particular function. For example, when del operates on a scalar function, it results in a vector function. The following is the representation of the del operator. This operator del is given by I cap into dou by dou x plus j cap into dou by dou y plus k cap into dou by dou z. So, this del could be interpreted as a vector of the differential operators. There are three differential operators here, each in a particular dimension: dou by dou x in one dimension along x axis, this is a differential operator, and dou by dou y and dou by dou z. So, this is the differential operator del. There are three ways in which this del operates on functions. The first of kind is the del operating on a scalar function, and it is called the gradient of a scalar function. Here T represents a scalar function, let us say temperature. So, it is called grad T. The second kind of operation is on a vector function. This del operates on a vector function as a dot product. It is called the divergence of a vector field. It is represented by del dot E, and it is also called as divergence of E. Here, say this E is a vector function representing electric field. Similarly, this del acts on a vector field as a cross product, denoted here del cross H, and this is called as a curl of a vector field or curl H. Here H is a vector function which represents a magnetic field. So, these are the three ways in which del operates on scalar functions and vector functions. The first kind of operation is the gradient of a scalar function, and the gradient of a scalar function is given by grad V. Here V is a scalar function, say it is a scalar function of electrostatic potential. It is represented by the equation grad V is equal to I cap into dou V by dou x plus j cap into dou V by dou y plus k cap into dou V by dou z. So, we know that this I cap, del is given by I cap into dou by dou x plus j cap into dou by dou y plus k cap into dou by dou z, and this del operates on V. So, each differential operator operates on V, and we get this gradient of a scalar function. Now, we shall understand the application of the gradient of a scalar function. So, to understand this better, we shall consider an example. Say, we have a positive charge here, and there are a series of points along x axis, and the potential at each and every point goes on decreasing as you move away from the charge. And if delta V is the potential difference between the two points, the negative sign indicates that the potential decreases as you move away from the charge. And if delta x is the separation, then the ratio minus delta v by delta x is equal to the electric field E. This is in case of one dimension, but the region around a charge is a three-dimensional space, and hence the electric field E could be represented as the negative gradient of potential. So, this electric field E is the negative gradient of potential. And also, this negative sign indicates that as you move away from the charge, the electric field also goes on decreasing. What is the physical significance of this gradient? The gradient of a scalar function results in a vector function. So, we get a vector quantity. This vector has both magnitude and direction. So, the gradient of a scalar function always points in a direction of maximum variation of the scalar function. And also, the magnitude of the gradient of a scalar function gives the rate of variation or rate of maximal variation in that particular direction. So, to understand this gradient better, we have a video here. Please watch this.
What is gradient of a scalar field? Consider air on the Earth's surface. We know that density is a scalar quantity. We also know that density of air is same at equal height from the Earth's surface. But as we move away from the Earth's surface, density of air decreases. Since density depends on its position in space, therefore it can be represented as a function of three axes, x, y, and z. Now consider any point, say A in space, having a density d. If we take the partial derivative of d at point A with respect to the axis x, y, and z, and then add them using the vector sum, we get a vector quantity. The magnitude of this vector quantity indicates the maximum rate at which the density increases, whereas the direction of this vector indicates the direction at which the density increases the most. Such a vector quantity is known as the gradient of density of air.
Now let us discuss the second type of operation of the differential operator, in this case on a vector field, and it is called the divergence of a vector field. The divergence of a vector field is mathematically written as the dot product of the differential operator and the vector field. In this case, vector E is a vector function that represents a vector field, which is nothing but an electric field. As per our previous discussion, we know that the equation for the differential operator is given by I cap into dou by dou x, j cap into dou by dou y, and k cap into dou by dou z. The vector function E is represented by the vector field E. So, we can write an arrow here. It is given by E is equal to E x into I cap plus E y into j cap plus E z into k cap. That is the vector function. The divergence construct is given by the dot product of this nabla and E. So, this is the dot product of the differential operator and the electric field. We need to multiply the respective components of unit vectors, because the other products they cancel out or they become 0, and hence The divergence of E is given by dou Ex by dou x, dou Ey by dou y and dou Ez by dou z. If you observe the right hand side, this right hand side RHS is a scalar quantity and hence divergence of a vector field is a scalar function or scalar quantity. What is the physical significance of the divergence of a vector field? The divergence of a vector field is a scalar quantity, it is just a number. Then what is its physical significance? The divergence measures how much vector field E spreads out from a given point of consideration. For example, let us say field lines are spreading out because of the charge in this region, let us say, and if I consider a point here, field lines are spreading out and how much field spreads is measured in terms of the divergence of the vector field E. And also let us consider a small volume, say this is a volume. This volume is in a region of space and the field lines are entering and the field lines are also leaving this particular space. So, the net outflowingness of the flux lines is also measured by this divergence of a vector field. So, the divergence of a vector field also measures the outflowingness of a vector field. Right. So, in case of a positive divergence, field lines always diverge and that point is considered to be a source of the field lines. See, in case of a positive divergence, field lines are diverging. So, it is a positive divergence and it is called as a source, that point is called as a source. In case of a negative divergence, these field lines, they converge or field lines are directed towards that point and this point is considered to be a sink. So, in case of electrostatics, positive charges are the sources and negative charges are the sinks. In case of a vector field, let us consider one such vector field. We have a vector field here, the magnitude of the the vector field keeps on changing, the strength of the vector keeps on changing. Even in this case, there is divergence because there is net outflowingness. What does it mean? If I consider a surface here or if I consider a small volume, the inflow and outflow, they are not same. Outflow is more, the inflow is less and hence even in this case, there is divergence. If the outflow is more, it is positive divergence. If the inflow is more, then it is the negative divergence. If the field lines are purely parallel, so the field lines are equal in magnitude and they are purely parallel, then such a case is called as zero divergence. If the field lines are purely parallel, then the divergence is zero. So, this is the application of the divergence of a vector field. So, to understand this better, let us watch this video.
Are particularly viscerally understood when the vector field is thought of as representing fluid flow, even if the field you're looking at is really meant to describe something else, like an electric field. Here, take a look at this vector field. And think of each vector as describing the velocity of a fluid at that point. Notice that when you do this, that fluid behaves in a very strange non-physical way. Around some points, like these ones, the fluid seems to just spring into existence from nothingness, as if there's some kind of source there. Some other points act more like sinks, where the fluid seems to disappear into nothingness. The divergence of a vector field at a particular point of the plane tells you how much this imagined fluid tends to flow out of or into small regions near it. For example, the divergence of our vector field evaluated at all of those points that act like sources will give a positive number. And it doesn't just have to be that all of the fluid is flowing away from that point. The divergence would also be positive if it was just that the fluid coming into it from one direction was slower than the flow coming out of it in another direction, since that would still insinuate a certain spontaneous generation. Now on the flip side, if in a small region around a point there seems to be more fluid flowing into it than out of it, the divergence at that point would be a negative number.
Hope it was a good simulation to understand divergence in a better way. The last kind of operation of the differential operator is again on the vector field and is called curl of a vector field. The curl of a vector field is mathematically represented as the cross product of the differential operator and the vector field. Here, the vector field is magnetic field and it is represented by a vector function h. So, according to the previous discussion, we know that the differential operator nabla is given by this equation, and we represent the vector field h by this equation h is equal to hx into I cap plus hy into j cap plus hz into k cap. The construct of the curl is given by the cross product of the differential operator and the vector function h. So, substituting for the differential operator and the vector function, we get this, there is a cross product here, and as per our discussion in the vector operations, this cross product could be written in terms of a determinant I cap, j cap, k cap, dou by dou x, dou by dou y, dou by dou z, and hx, hy, and hz. Remember, after expansion, this results in a vector quantity, and hence the curl of a vector field results in a vector field. And also, the curl of a vector field is in a direction perpendicular to this h or the vector field. Now, let us understand the physical significance of this curl of a vector field. So, the curl of a vector field is vector field, and also it is a measure of how much field swirls around a given point. For example, let us say there is a whirlpool. In case of a whirlpool, the water particles are rotating like this, there is a whirlpool here. Okay. So, if we consider a point, the particles are swirling, and velocity vectors, here we represent a velocity field, and there is a swirling of velocity field here, and how strongly the swirling is occurring is measured in terms of the curl of a vector field. Therefore, curl is a measure of how much vector field swirls or curls around a given point. Similarly, you can imagine a twister where the particles are swirling around, and the magnitude of that swirling is measured as curl. How strong the swirling is measured in terms of the curl. So, let us consider a conductor. There is a conductor here and it is carrying current, and consider a point on the conductor. And with respect to this conductor, we can consider as magnetic, we can consider a set of magnetic field lines. They are nothing but concentric circles, and stronger the current, more will be the curling of the field. And therefore, there is a relationship between the current and the curling of the field, and it is given by the Ampere's law, which we will discuss in the coming topics. If the curl is in the clockwise direction, then the curl is taken to be positive. This is a positive curl. If the curl is in the anti-clockwise direction, then the curl is taken to be negative. Okay, this is a negative curl. And also, if we have a vector field of this form, where the magnitude of the vector field is changing, then even in this case there is curve. For example, if this represents a water flow, the velocity of the flow is higher in the upper layers. Here the velocity is lower in these layers. Hence, if you put a twig on the surface, it tends, you know, it turns. Therefore, there is a curling effect. Even in this case, even though the vectors are parallel, there is a curling effect. Okay, but in case of a vector field where the field lines are purely parallel and the magnitudes are same, then this at any point inside this field, you know, the curl is zero. So, if the field lines are purely parallel, it results in a zero curl. Here at this point the curl is zero. So, let us have a better visualization of this curl through this video. Please watch this video.
For the curl at a given point, you also think about the fluid flow around it, but this time you ask how much that fluid tends to rotate around the point. As in, if you were to drop a twig in the fluid at that point, somehow fixing its center in place, would it tend to spin around? Regions where that rotation is clockwise are said to have positive curl, and regions where it's counterclockwise have negative curl. And it doesn't have to be that all of the vectors around the input are pointing counterclockwise or all of them are pointing clockwise. A point inside a region like this one, for example, would also have non-zero curl, since the flow is slow at the bottom but quick up top, resulting in a net clockwise influence.
So, with this we complete the discussion on the topics of today's session. Let us have a summary of what all we discussed in today's session. We discussed about the scalar field. The scalar field is a region of space in which each and every point is associated with a scalar quantity. Then we discussed about the vector field. A vector field is a region of space in which each and every point is associated with a vector quantity. Then we discussed about the differential operator. This differential operator operates on a scalar field and it instructs to differentiate the function, scalar function. Okay. Then we discussed about the gradient. This differential operator operates in three ways. First, it operates on a scalar field as a gradient. So, this gradient gives the maximum variation of the scalar field and its direction. Next kind of operation is divergence. In case of divergence, you know, the field diverges or converges. If the field diverges at a given point, we say it is positive divergence, or it is also called as source. In case if the field converges, it is considered to be the negative divergence, or it is considered to be the sink. So, that is the physical significance of divergence, and also it is a measure of the net outflowingness of the field. And the final operation is curl. The curl of a vector field is a measure of how much field swirls around a given point. So, how strong the swirling is. So, if the swirling is clockwise, the curl is positive. If the swirling is counterclockwise, the swirling is negative. With this, we have come to the end of today's session. And before closing, let us have a self-assessment through MCQs. The first MCQ is, the gradient of a scalar field points the direction. There are four options here: of the maximum variation of the scalar field, which is the first option; second option, of the minimum variation of the scalar field; third one, in random; fourth one, none. Please pick your choice. Of course, this gradient always points in the direction of maximum variation of the scalar field. Hence, option 1 is the correct answer. Now, we have the second MCQ. Please observe these diagrams carefully. We have four diagrams A, B, C, D. Based on that, you need to choose the proper answer. There are four diagrams here. The first diagram A, here the vectors are swirling. second diagram above there are vectors which are directed in the directed towards the right, and below they are directed towards left, and here the vectors are spreading, and here the vectors are directed in the same direction, but there is a change in magnitude. So based on our discussion, referring to the above diagram, choose the correct option. There are four options here. The first option is A and B represent a non-zero curl. This is A and this is B. And option 2 is C and D represent non-zero divergence, these two. And 3 answers, that is both the options 1 and 2, that is both the options 1 and 2. And the fourth one is none. So choose the correct option. Yes, friends, if you observe the four figures here, in the first one there is a curl, okay, because the vectors are swirling around a point. We can consider that point here, at the center. And similarly, if we consider a point here, above this the vectors are directed to the right, and below the vectors are directed to the left, and hence again there is curl here. Therefore, option 1, A and B represent non-zero curl, is correct. And if you consider C and D, if you consider a point here, there is divergence. Even in this case, there is divergence because there is net outflowingness. And option B also seems to be correct. But see the third one, both the options 1 and 2, of course, A and B represent non-zero curl, and C and D represent a non-zero divergence, and hence the most appropriate answer is option 3, and none is not possible. Hence the correct option is 3, option 3. So with this we have come to the end of the session. Let us close the session with a quote by Thomas Alva Edison. I have not failed, I have successfully discovered 10,000 things that won't work. How beautiful it is. Okay, this is the quote by Thomas Edison. So let us wrap up the class. Wish you all the best. Have a great day. Bye.